Mott has taken some of the best ever photos of the biggest acts in music over the past 30 years. They include the Rolling Stones, Michael Jackson, Elton John, INXS, and many, many more. And he is with us on the couch right here at Studio 10. Yay! Hi. Now, you have thousands and thousands of photos in your portfolio. Let's start with a little band called, the Rolling Stones?
Pretty amazing little band.
Yeah. You toured with them three times, is that right?
I've toured with the Stones three times and Mick Jagger once when he did a solo tour
and
of Australia.
What was it like being up close and personal with these rockers?
Actually, strangely, the bigger they become, the easier they are. Photographic-wise, the Stones are very generous, really open to having their photographs taken. And Mick Jagger, particularly, is very personable. Keith, not so much. Keith's just interested in other musicians. I call them the yin and yang of rock and roll. Like Mick's the charming one, and Keith only talks to other musicians.
Really? Is he just very shy and...
No, not shy, just totally obsessed by music and sound check. He's incredibly important to Keith, not so important to Mick.
And is it true that Keith is
allowed... Well, he knows that he's going to do it. Doesn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, they have a stand-in for the vocals for Mick Jagger, so he's often not a soundcheck. But I never saw Keith miss a soundcheck. It's very important. Mm. And he does this. They have about 68 songs rehearsed, and they only play 28. So they've almost got three shows. They've got certain songs set in concrete, so it's never boring. And on a great night, they really are the best rock and roll band in the world.
They certainly are. Is it true that Keith Richards has in his rider that he's allowed to smoke wherever he plays?
Who's going to stop?
Yeah.
Because I'm in the pit between the band and the audience. At the end of the night, there's about 400 fag ends of Keith.
Just
flick them out into the pit. No, I don't think anyone's going to stop Keith.
No, I don't think so, somehow.
Yeah, what can you do?
Now, you started your photography career with shots of Chrissy Amphlett and the Divinyls.
I did.
Another band that just, you know, exploded onto the scene.
That was my big lucky break. I was a French chef by trade. I used to work in King's Cross. Finished work about 10 or 11, and the Piccadilly Hotel in King's Cross was where the Divinyls started. They had, in the 80s particularly, bands had residencies, so every single Tuesday night the Divinyls were there. And I went down, I watched this crazy female banshee in front of me, and one night I thought, God, that's going to be difficult to photograph, and that was literally the start. And I started basically practicing on Chrissy Amphlett. And in, not that I knew at the time, but looking back on it, and I've now toured with about over 1,000 female artists. She's number one performer. Yeah.
Really? Oh, that's fabulous.
No one touches her as a performer. Yeah. Albums are more debatable, the music's debatable, but as a performer, unbelievable. I mean, I often feared for my safety, her safety, the audience safety, but she was completely unpredictable.
Because the live shows were legit. Like, she just threw herself around on the stage, right?
Absolutely wild.
Take us some of the craziest stuff that you'd see.
She used to have this trick where, particularly in the clubs of Sydney, where girls would go to the front of the stage to watch and they put their handbag down. She used to pinch handbags on a fairly regular basis, pull out whatever was there, sling them about.
Oh.
If anybody had the audacity to say, show me your... they would get not only a verbal response, they'd get a physical response.
Oh my goodness.
I've seen her go in and attack.
Wow.
She's a wild child. I've seen her deck a very famous female artist in a nightclub.
Really?
Who?
I don't want to mention her name.
No, don't.
But she's got a couple of nice famous... Anyway, they're in a club and she just came over and said, oh, you and I should go for a drink because we've got so much in common. And she just turned and said, what the hell have we got in common?
Oh, wow.
And I did befriend Chrissy in the last 10 years of her life. We became friends, and I've often mentioned that incident. And she said, basically, I'm going to get them before they got me. It was insecurities.
Oh, wow.
So she was, she was, unbelievable, as I say, unbelievable performer.
Well, tell us about Michael Hutchins.
Unbelievably charming man. And I think I often say he had 6 ex-girlfriends at his funeral. And three of them flew around the world for it. That's pulling power. I know it's a strange thing to say.
No. That means that he was a decent human being.
He really was. He was very charming. On offstage, sort of quite quiet, really. And when you spoke to him offstage, he wasn't the... I mean, he did party hard and the whole bit, but, he was a charming man and a great front man. I mean, he really was a great front man.
Tony, what is it that is the key to capturing a great rock and roll shot?
Well, I think rock and roll photography gets into two categories. There's the live and there's the session. When you're doing live, the good news is the musician's in their natural environment and you're just capturing what they do live. When you've got them off stage, you've got a bit of a problem because you've got all the control of the lights, but they're out of their natural environment. Mm-hmm. And contrary to popular belief, a lot of musicians are very uncomfortable in front of a camera. Mm. So my first thing is to try and get some sort of comfort zone. It's good to meet them, chat with them, drink with them, party with them. But it's Sarah McLachlan would be a good example of someone who's petrified of a camera. And had I not met her and spent a couple of days with her, it would have been that much harder. I just had to... shoving a lens in someone's face is actually intimidating.
That's not Sarah McLachlan, by the way.
That is not Sarah McLachlan.
Is he lovely? I bet he's...
Paul McCartney's really lovely. And this was... I toured with Paul and Linda in 93 or 94. And they were quite obviously very, very in love. Mm. But whenever he was having a good night on stage, he wasn't looking around to band members, he'd look around to Linda and sort of go, it's cooking tonight. I saw them, they held hands a lot together. They were just quite obvious. And they were a lovely couple. I used to describe them as millionaire hippies. they had a vegetarian chef on the road with them. No roadies were allowed to eat meat. You weren't allowed on the road. So there used to be like a conveyor belt down to the nearest McDonald's for the roadies. but they were, they couldn't have been lovelier. And when I first met Paul McCartney, I was told not to mention the Beatles. He never stopped mentioning the Beatles the whole time. And he was just, he was very easy to get on with. And he had all these pictures of the Beatles in Sydney, and he wanted to go back to these locations and recreate the photos. So I had a fun couple of weeks with McCartney.
Now, tell me, when you take all these photos, how many photos would you take in one night at a concert?
In the old days of film, you were more restricted and you probably take 5-6 rolls. In the digital age, you overshoot, which is, again, the old yin and yang was a good thing and a bad thing. You took a lot more care and it was much more difficult in film days. But on a big night, you'd take, 400, 500 frames. And when I used to do films and a lot of students used to get demoralised, the reality was it is a difficult thing to do live photography, and as long as you get a good shot on a night, that's a good night.
Don't black and white shots are fabulous.
Yeah, black and white still looks fantastic. It's still
so dramatic.
Do you think digital cameras have made photographers worse? Because they don't have to wait for that perfect
shot? They might get lazy. Yeah. In the old days, particularly in studios, I used to be perpetually with a light meter in front of you going, if someone's just changed that light, I'd be always... Whereas now you just look on the back of the camera going, it's still working. Yeah. In the old days, you were very aware of light. And as a consequence, you were aware of a light coming in from a window, diffused light. Mm. You knew what looked... Like, constantly, when I'm looking at people, I look at you now and think, there's a bit of shadow coming over there, so I fill in and things like that.
Actually,
you
do that's just naturally. How I look.
And also, when I'm in Sydney, when I'm wandering around, end of the day, I'll see a light bouncing up a wall and I'll go, that looks fantastic. 5 o'clock one afternoon, I must bring someone there. Mm. So you're always aware of light.
What I love about photographers, they're always looking at the world in terms of a shot and framing and that.
Almost perpetually. I've done a lot of travelling in Nepal, India. I've just come back from Ladakh. And a girl just saw me in Kathmandu Square with the camera. And she said, have you ever come down here without your camera? And I went, no, why would I do that? And it sort of stuck in my brain. And the next day I did, just because she said it. And I suddenly realised, oh, my God, it's different. I'm always framing. When no camera, you're just watching everyday life. Yeah. So, but it's not a bad thing. It's just that's fantastic. What
I'm saying. Tony's collected his best photos and put them all in one fantastic book. It's called... Alphabet A to Z, Rock and Roll Photography. Tony Mott, always lovely to talk to you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It's a great Christmas present.
It's available from www.tonymott.com.
Perfect. Okay.